Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome our viewers in this program, Hajj Day Today, where we actually broadcast from Mecca live every day during the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, and we will continue up to the 11th day. We will trace some of the topics which are related to Hajj, how to perform Hajj, the wisdom behind Hajj. In this program, we will actually broadcast from Mecca during the first 4 days, and then we will move to Mina, where we will have different topics, and it is live. I need to remind you that this is a very special program, and it is broadcasting live from Mecca, where millions or thousands of Hajjis come from all over the world aiming the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I need also to remind you that we will show our phone number where you can call us and interact with us. In today's episode, we will actually, first of all, I would like to welcome our very special guests, first doctor from the left side is Dr. Ahmed Saifuddin. Actually started with Dr. Ahmed because he is our teacher and our sheikh actually. And then Dr. Omar Al-Juhani of Imam University. Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Omar. Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Ahmed. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you. In today's session, we basically talk about, or its title is, the rituals of Hajj, rituals and objectives, or aims or wisdom. So we are trying to elaborate the hidden and subtle secrets of ibadah. And our basic intent is how to translate all of those meanings into our real life, and how to dynamically change ourselves through the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So at the beginning, we need to clarify the meaning of ibadah, because most of us, and most of the Muslims, they think that the word ibadah, or an act of worship, is just to pray, just to make hajj, to make a charity, or to make zakah, the five pillars of Islam, and it is restricted only to fixing those rites and those rituals, regardless of the other aspects of life. So my first question actually is to Dr. Ahmed. What is the meaning of the word ibadah, the concept of worship in Islam?
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. We always start in the name of Allah, the Compassionate, the Merciful. We praise Allah سبحانه وتعالى, the Almighty, for all His bounties and favors, and we send our peace, our greetings to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. We ask Allah to bless him, to send him peace, and for all the companions and the followers until the day of judgment.
Ameen.
Coming into the question of ibadah, and you said it rightly, that the concept of ibadah may not be clear in the minds of some Muslims, when in fact ibadah is any act, whether it's like in the form of the regular duties that a Muslim is supposed to perform, such as Salah and Zakah and Hajj and Siyam, all of these various acts, or anything beyond that. It's a whole holistic term, if you will, for everything that Allah loves, whether this is an apparent one or a hidden one, something that is inside the heart, because the heart does perform ibadah. The mind does perform ibadah. The various parts of the body is involved in ibadah. So anything that you do, which is liked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and beloved to Him, is a form of ibadah. Even coming to the concept of performing anything that is in response to your natural desires and enjoyments, such as intimacy between one's wife or husband. If you intend with this to please Allah, to keep to the permissible and not to go beyond, is a form of ibadah as well.
So you mean that if it fulfills a meaning, which is like the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if it fulfills a call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like for example, a student who studies, a person who works, somebody who does his duties, an engineer, a doctor, all of those are actually involved in ibadah, or this is dunya, this is some of the worldly activities.
If they do it with the intention to please Allah and to go by His own rules, because the condition here is not to engage in anything that in violation of Allah's commandments, subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you keep to this, you are doing ibadah. So it has to have to meet two conditions. First, the act has to be right and supported by evidence from the glorious Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet, peace be upon him. And it has to have, you have to have the intention to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because we say the intentions do change habits into acts of worship. النيات تحول العادات إلى عبادات. That's the meaning in Arabic, which the intentions do change habits into acts of worship. So anything that's why, for example, in Hajj, all of the things that you do from the starting point, once you intend to come to please Allah and to perform this duty prescribed upon every Muslim who's able to do it, then that becomes part of your own ibadah. Just the mere intention itself is the start, is an act of ibadah, and it's the beginning of coming into all the actions involved. Even if you intend to sleep, for example, in order to get some rest and then to get some energy to do ibadah such as tawaf or tasbih or qiyamul layl or any act that is good for you and is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then it's considered ibadah.
So what I understand is ibadah includes, for example, acts of the heart like tawheed,
of course,
believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, believing in the six articles of faith. Ibadah includes visible acts. Ibadah includes also having trust in Allah, love in Allah, love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is visible and invisible. Has two basic conditions. Number one, it should be offered sincerely for the sake of Allah, and it should be right in the sense that it is as it is made or done or practiced by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are the basic conditions. But those ibadat or those acts of worship, sometimes some people they look at them that they are static, in the sense that you have to listen and to obey. You have to receive the text and to implement it as is. You don't think, you don't contemplate. And this is my question actually to Dr. Omar. Am I required actually to do any act of worship without searching for its meaning, what I can call its reason, its wisdom? Because all the acts of worship in the Quran, in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they are not just, they were not just mentioned as is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in some acts of worship, He mentioned some reasons. Like for example, when we talk about fasting, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about piety or taqwa as the fruit of fasting. So again, do we should actually just implement what we learn without searching for reasons, or we should actually look for reasons? And what are those reasons for ibadat?
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله رب العالمين ونصلي ونسلم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. وبعد the concept of wisdom behind the acts of worship is actually deeply rooted in the textual material, whether the Quran or the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the derivatives of these many a times are apparent, clear, and sometimes they are within the need of being derived. Derivatives have taken place by many of the earlier scholars, like the likes of Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, the likes of Imam al-Shatibi, the likes of Ibn Abidin. Many of these earlier scholars have actually put this as a independent science that is known as the purpose behind the acts of worship.
And also Shah Waliullah Dahlawi, the Muslim Indian scholar, he wrote about it.
Right.
Of the reason.
So the material, the literature is there. The science is established. It's well understood. And the example you gave regarding that fasting, for example, the purpose behind it isn't just to feel the hunger and the thirst and restrain from the concept of intimacy with one's spouse, but rather there's a further purpose, and this purpose is to remain within the acts, within the attitude of the Muslim, and this is the concept of taqwa, where Allah says لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, that hopefully you may gain piety or you may be pious. And piety isn't just a matter of doing it during the fasting part, but rather it should go further into the acts and the life of a believer. That would be the fruit, that would be the actual result and purpose that has been fulfilled from this act of worship.
So if I ask
yes, you the question, if someone reads the Quran, reciting the Quran dry from any understanding of what's being recited, this person is actually not benefiting from the meanings of the recitation.
Exactly.
If a person prays the Salah, the five mandatory prayers or the voluntary acts of Salah, and they do not realize what they're saying, for example, during the Salah, when they say إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, O Allah, you alone we worship and you alone we seek assistance from. If the person repeats these words and doesn't really realize the meanings, that it is establishing the concept of the oneness of Allah in worship, it's establishing the concept of dependence on Allah, an act of worship of the heart and the entirety of a person's entity. If these concepts are not there, then the benefit of the purpose behind the salah, as Allah tells us, inna salata tanha anil fahsha'i wal munkar, prayer does deny a person from falling into concepts of wrongdoings or oppressing themselves. And the further going into the ayah, wala dhikrullahi akbar, the purpose really is to revive and imbibe the concept of remembrance of Allah. As-Sa'di rahimahullah, the famous commentator of the Quran, he says that this is amongst the most greatest purposes, maqasid of salat, to bring a person into a state of consciousness and to restrain from falling into wrongdoings, but at the same time to connect with Allah Azza wa Jal. Hence the end of the ayah, or close to the end, وَلَا ذِكْرُ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرُ,
so
and the remembrance of Allah is greater.
So if I stop you here, which is dhikr here, doesn't mean it just remembering by the tongue.
Yes.
As you translated it, as a consciousness, a feeling
right.
of consciousness,
right. Right.
a feeling of piety, of feeling right. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Yes, the involvement of the heart, the mind, and of course the bodily movements that are involved.
So there is a meaning behind an act of worship. There is something which is intended by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he obligated or when he actually
prescribed
enacted
this act of worship.
Such
yes.
an act
yes.
or such an activity. And
if I may add here, first we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is wise. He is al-hakim. He would not legislate anything unless there is a strong and a valid reason for having this being an obligation upon the Muslims. Mm. So he does not do anything in vain. Rather, there is a wisdom. Sometimes the wisdom is very apparent, and we can see it. But even there are certain things that our comprehension as human beings may not reach or may not comprehend fully. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so wise and indeed knowledgeable. He has all the knowledge and all the wisdom that can be given for any particular obligation. Let me just add to that.
Okay, I'm sorry because we have to go for a break.
All right.
But before going to the break, I'd like to just summarize it in one sentence, that out of the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that there is a wisdom behind the acts that He enacted on us. This number one. Number two, there must be a reason, that we agreed that there must be a reason behind any act, and there is a meaning which is intended by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to search for it and we have to get it. After having this break, inshallah, we'll talk about the objectives of Hajj, inshallah. So our viewers, stay with us. Don't turn the channel, don't go outside. Remain with us, inshallah. We'll have a short break and we will be back very soon, inshallah.
Huda TV's social media sites are the best way to contact us from anywhere around the world. Stay connected with Huda TV's latest news and programs through Facebook, Twitter, Google+, YouTube, Skype, and Instagram. It's fast and easy. Stay up to date with your favorite shows and scholars today. Huda TV, a light in every home.
يا ذا الجلال والإكرام يا حي يا قيوم لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين اللهم أحسن عاقبتنا في الأمور كلها وأجرنا من خزي الدنيا وعذاب الآخرة برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم أصلح لنا ديننا الذي هو عصمة أمرنا وأصلح لنا دنيانا التي فيها معاشنا وأصلح لنا آخرتنا التي إليها معادنا واجعل الحياة زيادة لنا في كل خير واجعل الموت راحة لنا من كل شر
لبيك اللهم لبيك
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and welcome back to our Hajj day today where we actually broadcasting from Mecca the intent of all people all Muslims coming to perform Hajj 1436 after Hijrah of the Prophet Again, we welcome Dr. Ahmed Saif and Dr. Omar. We stopped on the point that Allah is the wise, the all-wise, the all-knowing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't intend just to exercise.
To burden us.
Exactly, to burden us with things which are meaningless.
Of course.
But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a reason behind all of this. And also, when we hit on the point we actually gain the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Right.
And the act of worship is what you can call it is interactive and dynamic, and it's easy to change, and it's easy to benefit from. This is a point here for Hajj, if we come for Hajj.
Right.
Looking and contemplating about Hajj, for sure it has objectives, and has reasons. What are the objectives of Hajj? Why do Muslims come all over the world, they kiss the stone, they circumambulate around the Kaaba, they go in between the two hills, go in a tedious journey from all the places, they go to Arafah, they wear ihram, they do all of those things. All those things are meaningless or they have a meaning. So my question to Dr. Ahmed, what are the real objectives of Hajj as
right.
you see them.
Let me pick up on the word tedious that you said.
Okay.
In fact, this particular worship.
Tedious for you this year?
Well, let me take it in the positive sense.
Okay.
That it's really involving in some kind of effort. You need to exert some effort. And we always remember that Hajj is one of the very highly demanding worships, because it involves financial obligation, physical obligation. So you need to exert some effort. You need to pay from your own earning and pocket in order to perform the Hajj. Some people would travel from faraway lands in order to come. Some people even collect wealth or the expenses for a long period of time, as in Malaysia, for example, where they created Tabung Haji, which is the bank for the poor people. Tabung Haji, which is the Hajj bank, so to speak, basically to collect for you as an individual what you need, and it will collect it. You collect it as much as you can. Once it reaches the amount needed for the expenditure of the Hajj, they will put you on the list, and then you will wait for your turn in order to be nominated to perform the Hajj. Now that people collect all their years order to perform this, so it's an aim. Yet, subhanAllah, this particular house, the Kaaba, has this temptation and gravity in the hearts of every believer. Every Muslim around the globe would love to come here and to perform the Hajj and to circumambulate around the house. There's this gravity which is instilled in the hearts of believers by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's just to compensate for some of the effort that you may exert and put in this respect. But let me tell you about the importance of Hajj in particular. Hajj is the fifth pillar of the faith. And it comes like in the order of having first the tenets of Islam, starting with La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, the kalima, or the word of faith, when you submit to Allah that He's the only deity worthy of worship and that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. Then you come to the prayer, and to zakat or charity, then to fasting the month of Ramadan, and then coming to Hajj. This shows the periods that is involved. Now, salah is a daily act. Zakat is a yearly act, but it also can be more than a year depending on the harvest of your crop and so on. So when you have your crop ready and it's already zakatable in terms of the amount of it, you have to give the zakat for it before you really get, or after you collect the crop from as a harvest. And then you go into the yearly month of Ramadan, which comes only once a year. Then you come to Hajj, which is required only once in your lifetime, even if you are able to do it physically and financially. Now, that's why it comes fifth. But it doesn't mean that it's less than the other ones. No, because all these ibadahs support one another. They all are pillars for the faith to stand on. That's why performing Hajj is important. And it really reflects the first tenet, which is the concept of Tawheed, the oneness of the Almighty. Because this house, which was built by Ibrahim, alayhi salatu wasalam, and his son Ismail, وَإِذْ يَرْفَعُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ وَإِسْمَعِيلُ رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَا. They were raising the foundation of the Kaaba in order to make it a place of announcing the Tawheed, to establish the concept of Tawheed and to make people come from around the globe just to come and show their due respect of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the house, and to single Him out in worship and not to look for anyone else. That's why I think the main concept of Hajj is to put all this effort to spend from your own money only to come and to announce La ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu al-mulk wa lahu al-hamdu wa ala kulli shay'in qadir. This word of submission. And again, لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك. So that's in Talbiyah, when you pronounce this word immediately after you embark upon your Hajj by getting into the state of Ihram, you say immediately, لبيك اللهم لبيك. Here I answer you, O my Lord. I answer you time after time, announcing that you are the only deity worthy of worship without any partner. So the basic need or the basic wisdom and reason behind the obligation of Hajj is to pronounce Tawheed, is to establish this.
Okay, so what I understand that humanity, after sending prophets, they used actually to have false deities, deities or false gods. They worship idols, they worship people, the animals, nature, etc. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this special house as a symbol of singling him alone with worship. And this is what I understand, that this is a basic objective of Hajj. This is a concept of Hajj. All the other practices which comes like tawaf, talbiyah, all those practices and activities which are involved in Hajj emphasize on that. When people they see this house, they remember that this is the first place that Allah commanded Ibrahim to build, to remind them of the natural instinctive inclination to worship only one God, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the basic objective, or this is the basic meaning that a person should achieve.
Yes.
So it is a call for everybody who... So if from the very beginning, when a person acquires his money, when a person announces talbiyah, when a person goes in everywhere, he emphasizes on this tawheed, worshipping one God. And this is the basic meaning.
I know that Dr. Omar would like to get
his special
involved. I know his turn is now. But let me say this concept.
Go ahead.
Which is Allah's unity is really resembled here through the unification of Muslims coming around the concept of unity of Allah and the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order to show it, as you said, in these various manifestations of worship. So they're not really intended just only to come and circumambulate the house or making tawaf around the Kaaba just for the sake of doing it, but rather to pronounce that tawheed and to show the submission that you're coming to the call of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, which was commanded by Allah, who was commanded by Allah to do it.
Exactly. So we have other objectives for Hajj, like, for example, objectives which are related to the person, to the individual, objectives which are related to the society or to the Muslim community, and other objectives which are related to the whole wallet. So, Dr. Omar, can you just give us a hint about those objectives and those meanings, just to remind our Hajjis and also to remind our viewers that whenever you see and whenever you practice any of those activities of Hajj, you need to remind yourselves of those meanings and those objectives.
Yes, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. I think what would define the concept of Maqasid al-Hajj, or the objectives of Hajj, is that we know that there are major objectives or major themes that Hajj alliterates. And we also know that there are sub-themes or sub-objectives, lesser in the manifestation of Hajj. Amongst the greatest objectives I think touched upon, and it's manifested greatly in the command that Allah gives Ibrahim in Surah Al-Hajj, when Allah tells him, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وإذ بوأنا لإبراهيم مكان البيت ألا تشرك بي شيئا.
This was Dr. Ahmed actually.
The concept of Tawheed. But okay. it really drives home another emphasis, which is the concept that is opposite to monotheism, that is not to associate partners with Allah, and that from the establishment of this house of Allah, the ancient house of Allah, Al-Baytul Atiq, that this concept has been completely denied. And even though after the time of Ibrahim, the concept of associationism crept back into the house of Allah, and the Meccans of the time of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam worshipped idols that were stationed there, the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam sent his cousin telling the world that from that moment there will be no more associationism in this house. And this gathering of Hajj, one of its greater objectives is to announce to the world that this place is only for those who believe in the oneness of Allah. And the entrance required for this house is to believe in the oneness of Allah. Hence where the magnitude of Tawheed really extends itself further and further.
Okay, this is an objective for the individual and also for the ummah.
Yes.
So what is the reflection for the person himself?
Well, the person, like, it goes further into the concept of what's known as mutaba'atun nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Following the Prophet
okay. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is the second part of the testimony. Hmm. We established the concept of tawheed and it being the very major theme of Hajj. But the second theme of Hajj, as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, khudu anni manasikakum. And to embody this, to literally take this journey and to follow in the footsteps of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is the concept of submission to Allah azza wa jal, and submitting to Allah in the way that Allah decreed, not in the way that maybe might appeal to our minds or hearts, but rather to what Allah decreed, and submitting fully into this concept without any contradiction whatsoever.
So this is tawheed and following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Yes, and of course another very important concept, which is known as wala and bara, and wala and bara here is manifested. And of course, wala and bara is a deep creed in the Muslims' belief, and it's translated roughly as associating with what pleases Allah and disassociating oneself with what displeases Allah Azza wa Jal. And how is this one of the main objectives of Hajj? Well, the journey of Hajj is deeply rooted in the history of the prophets and the messengers. So when I perform Hajj, when I do the acts of Hajj, I relate myself to Ibrahim. I associate myself to Ibrahim. And if the narration that is considered to be a lesser narration, that even Adam alayhi salam came to the house of Allah and performed Hajj, then my association is to the father of mankind, the one who worshiped none other than Allah, Adam alayhi salam. Going further to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in the perfection of the concept of associating with the concept of what pleases Allah, and disassociating ourselves with what displeases Allah.
So the meaning here is to ask myself a question. Where am I in the whole line of history as a Muslim? That before the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the line of Tawheed goes on, and I'm here to follow the same path of all prophets and messengers who came and visited this house. Still, this is some aspects of the objectives of Hajj. We have a short break right now. No, but we will continue, inshallah, talking about this question, because we need actually to cover the individual, the objectives on the community, the society, and humanity also of Hajj, and the meanings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to learn and to understand and to apply also. And this is what we will have after having this short break. So we'll invite our viewers, don't leave us, continue. We'll discuss about the different categories of the objectives of Hajj and how to translate them into our own lives and behavior, inshallah. So follow us. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back after having this short break in Hajj Day today, where we actually broadcasting from Mecca live with Dr. Omar and Dr. Ahmed. I invite you actually to participate and call us any inquiries or any questions, inshallah. We stopped before the break on classification of the objectives of Hajj, and you need actually them in a list. Okay. So please, we try to be concise and to the point, which is what are the impact of Hajj on an individual? What are the objectives of Hajj?
Just a brief
comment on what my brother Omar said already regarding al-wala wal-bara,
yes,
loyalty and disloyalty. Loyalty and allegiance to the believers and disloyalty with the non-believers. Mm. And that's important. But some people would carry that meaning into showing this through demonstrations and all this and changing this form of ibadah and act of the heart into demonstrations, into slogans and raising banners and all this, which is absolutely not intended and it may be misinterpreted as some people have tried in the past to do it or may intend to do it in the future. So that's a little comment on this topic. Going into the benefits of Hajj, obviously to learn as an individual, you will benefit a lot and you will achieve many of the purposes behind coming to Hajj. You'll learn how to be sincere. You'll learn how to, as we already stated, follow the footsteps of the Prophet, peace be upon him. You try not to harm Muslims because you know it's not allowed for you even to harm the trees or the birds inside the sacred area. How about hurting your fellow Muslims or your brothers and sisters who are coming here? From this you would learn to even respect other Muslims and human beings in general. And look at what is happening in the world nowadays, where many who belong to, who come under the fold of Islam, who really transgress against their fellow Muslims under many interpretations which are basically wrong, to really shed their blood or to get into a fight with them. That's not intended. From Hajj you can learn how to respect the human life and how to feel as this is very, very important to stop short of harming Muslims in any particular way. From this you learn also how to do good things, how to be compassionate, how to do ibadah in a collective way, because these ibadahs, basically the main features of Hajj, are done in a collective way. The tawaf is done collectively, sa'i is done collectively, throwing pebbles at jamarat is done collectively, standing on the plain of Arafat is not physically standing, but rather to be on the plain of Arafat during the day of Arafat, in engaging directly into supplication and remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, invoking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for mercy, for kindness, for forgiveness and so on, is important. How to reconciliate your own whims and desires. You're not here only to show that you are a king, a president, a chairman, a holder of PhD, you're a CEO of your own company. This doesn't matter. What matters is that you're standing, you're a guest of Allah. You're coming in the company of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being with so many Muslims around you. So you need to humble yourself, to teach yourself that you came from dirt, you're going back to dirt, you are a human being, you're so much in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why we dress these two pieces of clothes as men, and even women would dress in a very simple way, and not to show arrogance or supremacy over others, not being someone from a particular tribe, or you're an Arab who is better than non-Arab, and so on and so forth. In the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all humans are equal. What matters is the taqwa or piety inside your heart. So all of these are coming indeed from.
So if we conclude then, all of those goes into the matter of training ourselves.
Of course.
We need to be trained, training, taming this soul. We need actually to have a feeling of need for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we were talking, sometimes a person understands that lesson when he is exposed to hard experience in his life. Like for example, when he has a disease and he feels that he is very weak, so he understands the point of how to be in need for Allah, craving after the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This what is expressed in one of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that people come to Allah in chains, in the sense that they are exposed to some type of catastrophes or problems in their lives and they return back to Allah. We need to understand these types of meanings in Hajj. So it is training, sincerity, submitting yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't ask why, but ask how. How should I do it? How I should actually rush into fulfilling what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded me to do. Also seeking rewards from Allah, because this is a mine of rewards of all acts of worship which are included in Hajj. Remembering Allah, which is dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is exemplified in every single step of Hajj. And as Dr. Umar said, that I have to put myself in the map or in the line of history. This is what I'm asking Dr. Umar about. Do other prophets and messengers visited or visit the Kaaba? Or for example, there is an authentic hadith about the mosque of Al-Khayf, I think.
Khayf in Mina.
Oh.
Yes.
Remember how many?
70. 70 prophets.
70 prophets
prayed, visited at Al-Khayf.
Al-Khayf Masjid, which is in Mina. So a Muslim is supposed to understand his context and the history of Islam when he comes to Hajj.
Yes, this is what we were relating to, the concept of loyalty to the prophets and the messengers, of course, to the concept of what Allah Azza wa Jalla has decreed. And the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam tells us, as the good doctor tells us, that 70 of the prophets prayed actually in this masjid, or in the area known as the masjid now. And the Prophet, when he was journeying to Hajj with his companions, he told them in a valley known as the Valley of Al-Azraq, what valley is this? And they told him, this is the valley of such and such. And he said, as if I can see my brother Musa traveling on a camel coming to Hajj with the proclamation of Talbiyah, with a voice loud and clear. And also Yunus, the Prophet says, Yunus alayhi salam, also came and performed Hajj. So the journey is deeply rooted in the history of the prophets and the messengers. Even in another narration, Salih and Hud and some of the other prophets who were prior to the time of Musa and closer to the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam, they also performed Hajj. Now, this is really one of the clearest concepts of Hajj, or the themes of Hajj, to be loyal to what pleases Allah and to disassociate oneself with what is with what displeases Allah Azza wa Jal. And to perfect this meaning, really, one of the greater also objectives of Hajj, and I think this is important to be mentioned before maybe I touch upon the objectives or the themes for the individual. For the greater theme of Hajj is a concept known as preservation of life. Preservation of life. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the ninth day, which is the day of Arafah, he stood and he gave his famous sermon, and he asked the companions and the people who were with him. He said, "Ayyu baladin hada? What city is this?" And they said, "Allahu wa rasuluhu a'lam." They thought that the Prophet's going to rename the city. He said, "Alaysa, is this not the sanctioned house? Is this not the land that Allah has made sanctioned?" And then the Prophet went on and said, "Ayyu yawmin hadha? What day is this?" And when they testified to the sanctity of the day, the month, and the house, or the land of Mecca, the Prophet said, "Now know that inna dima'akum wa amwalakum wa a'radukum alaykum haram."
Allahu Akbar.
Understand that your blood, your wealth, and your kinship and family and lineage are prohibited amongst yourselves. And what makes this really one of the greater objectives of Hajj is when the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said this on the 9th, he repeated it again on the 10th. And hence that the 9th is Yawm Arafah, the 10th is Yawm An-Nahr. These are the two greatest days of the year and the greatest days in the sight of Allah Azza wa Jal. And then repeats it again on the 11th. The Prophet says, "What day is this?"
And same thing.
The same exact sermon, and emphasizes on the concept, "Inna dima'akum alaykum haram."
SubhanAllah.
Saying that your blood, the shed of blood, is considered to be prohibited amongst you. And when one understands this theme of Hajj, we have no other choice but to stand in awe and in rejection to what we see today happening. In the name of Islam and in the name of Allah, which we say Allah and the Deen of Islam are both exonerated from this from this act and this evil way that claims to be within Islamic teaching.
So we need to understand that there is something sacred. There's something which is protected, and on the top of that is blood.
The life, preservation of life.
The preservation of life. Yes. And this is a very meaning, very important thing. Actually, I'm very short of time, and we have only a minute and a half. The most important question here in this episode is how to acquire in a practical program, whatever, how to be practically gaining those objectives of Hajj or any ibadah. I'm suggesting number one, is it necessary actually to prepare myself before Hajj to change?
Yes.
Does it need actually to, so number one, willingness to change myself? Do I need to stop in every single site and activity of Hajj to understand, to learn, and to contemplate over, and then to respond in my manners and behaviors, etc.?
Well, if I can give a very short answer to this, and then I'll give it back to my uncle.
No, go ahead.
The journey of Hajj manifested in the two cloths, the journey coming to the house of Allah, the ancient house of Allah, and realizing that we will be gathered on the Day of Judgment the same way. This, I believe, is a message that every person who looks and sees and experiences Hajj should take the message back home and live the life that is required by us.
So the beginning and the end.
From Allah's
own. You remember your beginning and your end. What else, Doctor?
Well, I would say that you have enough time during Hajj to reflect upon the journey and what you are here for. Therefore, actually, you need to learn first and to have the pure intention while you are doing this to think that, why am I doing this? Ask the question, why am I doing this? Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala need me to do this particular act at this particular time on this particular site? This is important. And again, seeing all these people in a sea of people coming around you, this reminds you of the Day of Judgment when people are going to be all raised and standing before Allah without any clothes.
Jazakumullah khairan. So we are actually out of time. We thank you all, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our Hajj and to make those who did not visit the Kaaba from making Hajj to attain it and to make it and to accept from them and to implement in their hearts the real meaning of Hajj and to change themselves. I appreciate your attendance and your participation.
Appreciate your work.
Jazakallah khair. Jazakumullah, barakallah fikum. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it from all of us. Wa assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك.